we come today to the fourth commandment, in which God commands us to honor the Sabbath, to remember the Sabbath day, and to treat it as holy. And as we're going to learn in the chapter, that has to do with both rest for us, but also renewing and reconnecting in our faith in God. So I'd ask you, what do you do when you renew? Where do you go? What are the places that you like to be that just calm your heart or soothe your soul or allow you to recreate, to recreate? And for me, it's always water. And I think about the Lake of the Ozarks. It's about 2.5 hours from my house in central Missouri. And when I go there, I love to get on a boat. I love to be on a paddle boat with my granddaughter. I love to just sit on the dock. And it is renewing for me. Well, for the ancient Egyptians, and maybe for the Israelites as well, part of that came through being on the Nile River. The Nile River was a central part of life in ancient Egypt. It was the source of life. It sustained life there. And I thought you might enjoy, again, because I want to take you to these places that tie into this story, I thought you might enjoy going to the Nile and just experiencing what you would experience if you were taking a journey down the Nile River. So let's head to Egypt. Let's take a journey down the Nile. Trip down the Nile River, and I hope you have a chance to experience it one day on your own. It was a remarkable experience to take a boat down the Nile River to experience and to see what Moses had to have seen many times as he was traveling between cities when he lived in Waset or Thebes or Luxor. So we want to focus on the commandment to honor the Sabbath, remember the Sabbath, and to keep it holy. And in this, I find that Christians do a really lousy job of remembering the Sabbath day, of honoring it in the way that God intended. And the people that I think do it the best are my Jewish friends. And so once more, we return to our conversation with Rabbi Art Nemetov. Let's take a listen to what he has to say about the Sabbath.
The Sabbath is central to who we are as Jews. We operate our entire calendar around Shabbat. We work for the week, waiting for Shabbat to come, and then we sadly say goodbye to it. It is a time of renewal, a time of rest, but more importantly, it's a time of imitation of God. It says in the book of Genesis that after 6 days, God then rested on the seventh. When I rest on Shabbat, I'm regenerating myself. I'm regenerating that soul that God has given me so that I can go out and do good in the world just as God does good in the world.
So what does Shabbat look like in terms of practice for you and your family and for the members of your community?
For me personally, Shabbat includes services with our community on Friday night. Shabbat begins on Friday evening at sundown. It continues till Saturday evening at sundown because it says in the book of Genesis, there was evening and there was morning the first day. So too our days begin in the evening and continue through the day. It begins with services in the evening and then it continues with a Sabbath meal with my family. And then Shabbat afternoon is a time to rest and relax. In a traditional world, it would be visiting with friends and family, no electronics, no driving. It would all be very natural and doing no work of any kind. I interpret a little bit more liberally. So for me, Shabbat will include a bike ride. Shabbat will include gardening with my wife at our house. Shabbat will include perhaps going to a movie together because I never have a chance to go to a movie. It's a time for me to do that which is relaxing and nourishing. It's definitely a time for family and friends. If we could, some of us would be on our phones and we'd be working 24/7. There is no longer that sense of walking out the door and turning the key and you have a different life. It's all been blended together. Shabbat is an opportunity to say, stop. Don't do that. You need to have this time for yourself to regenerate your soul, to regenerate your family. And that's what the gift of Shabbat is for us.
Yeah.
What I love about Shabbat is we don't ask God to do anything on Shabbat, on the Sabbath. With one exception, we ask for peace. We praise God for what we have in the world.
So we allow God to rest
exactly.
On the seventh day, just
exactly.
As we do. That's wonderful. For many of our people who visited the Holy Land, and you get to the Holy Land and you find elevators, the buttons are all pushed, you're going to stop on every floor. for Christians, sometimes it seems like taking the commandment to a degree that feels almost absurd. And so explain that. Help us understand why that's not the case and what's beautiful or good about that.
If God says to you, jump, what do you ask?
How high?
But you don't just ask how high. You ask when, how often, where, what direction. There are 100 questions you ask. Because if, in fact, God is your God and you have this intimate relationship and you want to please God, you want to do things exactly the way that God wants you to do it. And so if God says to me, do not work on Sabbath, I want to know exactly what it is that God is expecting of me.
What constitutes work?
Exactly. And so if work constitutes creating something or changing status, every time I push a button on an elevator, I'm creating a circuit. I'm creating something. And while it may not feel like work to us, it is the intent behind the prohibition. And so in order to be as true to God as one possibly can be, one goes to as many extremes as one can. And I don't mean that in a negative sense. It's the notion in Judaism of building a fence around the Torah, that you don't want to violate the laws. You want to honor God in the best way possible. And therefore, you build this fence so that you don't even accidentally violate those principles, that you continue to stay true to God. In liberal Judaism, it's a little bit different. I don't particularly feel I am doing work when I'm pushing a button. But from a traditional perspective, it's very powerful. And it creates, by the way, a humility and a carefulness in life that I think is very valuable for all of us.
Mm-hmm. So one last question, unless I think many people would be curious about. How does the Friday evening service differ from the Saturday morning service? And do people attend both, or are there different people who attend each of those?
I'd like them to attend both. Friday night services are called, in our tradition, Kabbalat Shabbat, literally receiving Shabbat. And it is a joyful, often song-filled service that has a series of psalms that celebrate God and celebrate God's goodness. And it is bringing joy and welcoming to the Sabbath bride. We view Shabbat as a bride and we are the groom. It comes from a poem in the 15th century. And that poem is called Lecha Dodi, and it imagines Sabbath to be a bride, and we welcome that bride into our lives. And think about whenever you've seen a bride come into a room, it's a moment of joy, a moment of beauty, and that's what we're welcoming into our lives. And it's a very brief service. It has a traditional structure, but it begins with this welcoming of Sabbath. Saturday morning, which is a more relaxed time because we're not at work, it's a longer service. Again, we don't ask God for changes. We ask God, we praise God for what God gives us, but we also study Torah. And so unlike Friday night, we take out the Torah scroll, which contains those 5 books of Moses, and we read from it. And we also read what's called the Haftarah, which is one of the prophets, a lesson of prophets that has the same theme as the section of Torah that we read that particular Saturday. And then often there is a sermon, a drasha, explanation, inspirational message that is offered on the Sabbath, on that Torah portion for the week. And that takes place on Shabbat morning.
Okay. So we return once more to the commandment. Remember the Sabbath day and treat it as holy. To remember it means to observe it. It means to take rest. It means to do the things that renew us and recreate us. This is a gift from God. But I don't want you to forget the last part. Treat it as holy. To treat something as holy is to treat it as belonging to God. And so this day is a gift from God. It belongs to God. And in the midst of treating it as holy, we spend time with God. We pray, we worship, we read scripture. I want you to make that a holy rhythm in your life, because it's in that time of worship, prayer, scripture study, listening for God's voice, being filled with God's Spirit, that we find our soul renewed. May you be blessed by observing the Sabbath, by remembering the Sabbath day. and treating it as holy.